What is up? Welcome to Etsy Jam. This episode, we have the pleasure of talking with Rebecca from Aegean Drawn. Rebecca has been on Etsy since 2015 and recently found her niche selling some awesome crochet dog costumes and hats. Rebecca shares some Yoda-inspired life-changing advice she received and how it helped her get her shop on track for success. Join us for a conversation about customer communication, selling original art on Etsy, international shipping strikes, and more. What is up? Welcome to Etsy Jam, the podcast where we have friendly conversations about serious topics. I am Gordon from Marmalead.
And I am Richie from Marmalead. And if you don't know what Marmalead is, it is the best Etsy SEO and market research tool for serious sellers. So if you're an Etsy seller who is serious about your shop, you need to go get yourself some Marmalead. Go on over to marmalead.com, pick some up. Also, it is what allows us to do this podcast because Gordon and I do Marmalead full time.
And today we have a very special guest with us. We have Rebecca from Aegean Drawn. Rebecca makes her home on Etsy, and she sells a lot of different crochet things. I don't want to spoil too much of the fun because she's got a really great backstory. So first of all, thank you for joining us today, Rebecca. It's awesome to have you.
Pleasure to be here.
And if you want to jump into just a little bit of your history and, you know, where you're living now and how you got there.
Sure. I guess I'll start at the beginning. I was originally born in Illinois, like rural Illinois, though, like where all the cornfields are. You guys being in the Midwest, you might get that.
Oh, yeah, cornfields. Sounds familiar.
It's just corn. Everywhere corn. From there, I spent about a year in California and then 4 years in Germany, which is where we got this lovely lady here, Lola.
She's adorable.
yeah. My husband was in the military, and then we were stationed there for about 4.5 years. So she was kind of our companion. She came from Wiesbaden, and I think her original name was Kara von Winkel, but we liked Lola better. Have you ever seen the movie Run, Lola, Run?
Yes.
It was like the first thing we ever saw in German.
Yeah.
The first everything that we learned about Germany. So that's how we got her name.
That's awesome.
But anyway, enough about my dogging for now, I guess. Other than that, after he got out of the military, we finished our contract. We moved back to Illinois, and I worked tech support at Blackboard for about 3 years.
Okay.
And after that. Yeah, it's pretty big, but we were off like on a an offshoot of it. That we got brought in via acquisition, so it was a lot of instability at that time. It made it a bit difficult. Mm-hmm. After that, see, my husband got a fellowship to go to Istanbul, which is what brought us to where we are now, Turkey. he spent about a year and a half in Istanbul, studying at a school there on a fellowship, and at some point we said, okay, let's try this out. Let's go along. So me, my dog, and two kids, I have two kids. We all decided to come along and give it a try, and it kind of stuck. So we ended up staying in Istanbul for a while, and I taught English there for a little bit.
Okay.
And then we moved to Izmir. Yeah. then we moved to Izmir in 2014, fall 2014, which is where we are now. It's a beautiful city on the coast. So if you're ever, okay, you know, yeah, around this way, it's like right across from Greece. So, you know, you have the Greek island, everything, and right across the sea is where we are right now. So,
gotcha.
but yeah, we've been in Izmir now for almost 3 years, 3.5 years. So
that's awesome.
It's my story.
It's probably pretty different, I would imagine, than rural Illinois for you.
Yeah, it's a big difference from where I grew up. That's sure. A lot of people are like, wow, your English is so good. I'm like, yeah, I hope so.
Yeah, I learned in like the heartland of English.
There's ferries that go back and forth to different parts of the cities here. That's one of the ways you can get around. We don't just have buses in the metro. We have ferries. Mm-hmm. I actually met someone once on the ferry from Illinois. Like, where is your accent from? Illinois.
That's crazy.
That's what happens when you live abroad, I suppose. You pick up on all these little bits of everybody's language enough so that it warps the way you speak a bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've heard that, yeah, to the point that people say that when they start living in different places, you know, when they go back home or something, people are like, where are you from? They're like, no, I'm from here, you know? And yeah. They're like, no, you're not. No. But stop. Then the people elsewhere are like, no, you're not from here either. Like, we know you're not from here. You don't talk like us.
That's funny. And okay, so, and with your history regarding Etsy, you kind of got started, maybe had a little bit of a slow start, like a lot of people do on Etsy. You know, it's not, you sign up and away you go with sales. But along the way, you kind of found your niche, it sounds like, as far as product is concerned anyway.
Right, right.
Do you want to give us
I mean, I guess I can start with why and how I started my Etsy shop. That I think was part of the problem. I began my Etsy shop in the spring of 2015. We'd been in Izmir for a little while, and your options here are pretty much teaching English or teaching English. And I tried that in Istanbul. I tried that, and it was okay. But it wasn't like my passion, you know. When we came here, it was middle of the semester. I was like, okay, I want to do something, you know, just in the interim. And I'd always been interested in art and crafts and, you know, just about everything. Like if you can name a craft, I probably did it, you know. So while I was here, I decided to try to start selling some of this stuff online. And so I did a Google search, okay, so how to sell your art online, you know, literally like something that basic. And one of the first things came up was Etsy. And my friend had bought all of her wedding supplies there. So I was like, oh, we'll try that. So I opened up my Etsy shop in 2015, March. And I kind of listed up everything.
Now, how did you pick what products you wanted to put in your shop when you first started?
I had a backlog of certain things that I'd been doing in Istanbul and here. Okay. Like I had a bunch of paintings that I'd done.
Oh, nice.
I'd done like some local jewelry. We talked about it a little bit in the pre-interview. Like supplies in Turkey are very cheap. And there's also this cultural bit that you don't really get in the States. Like there are special, you know, beads here that you can't really find anywhere else. And like the yarns here are very cheap and everyone crochets. You know, it's just something people do. Like everyone does. So I picked up on some of these crafts and just started thinking, okay, well, I can make all this stuff. Why not, you know, try to sell it? So I just kind of threw it all out there, which of course, you know, didn't go very well for me at first. So after about 3 months of, you know, trying different things and getting on different Facebook groups and, you know, I found you guys, you know, I found all that. I was kind of getting frustrated, like, okay, it's been 3 months. I haven't had a sale, single sale. I get the views, I get the favorites, no sales, no nothing. So it was discouraging. And I got on one of these groups and I kind of said, okay, here's my shop. I didn't want to ask for help until I got to the point where I felt like I was trying and doing stuff. You know, what can I do? You know, when, what is the cutoff for this kind of thing? You know, how much longer should I try before, you know, just kind of cutting the cord and saying I'm done. Because I'm throwing myself out there, you know, what more can I do? When do I stop? When do I draw the line with my Etsy shop? And I was expecting someone to get on there and be like, oh, I'll give it 4 months, give it 5 months, you know, oh, you know, do this, do that. And I did get a few of those comments on there. But the thing that really stuck out to me is the leader of this group. I don't think he's actually even on the group anymore. I'm admining the group now.
Oh, okay.
But basically, he got on there and basically gave me the Yoda speech, the, you know, the do or do not, there is no try. You know, he came out and just told me basically, you know, if it's something you want, do it. If it's something you don't really care about that much, then don't. But you know, you have to either commit to it or don't. It's your choice. If you want it, then go get it. So
and did you at the time
it felt like really
I was just gonna say, did you feel like you were already committing to it, or did you kind of feel like you were might have been holding back a little bit and not giving it everything?
I felt like I was giving it a lot because I was doing it full time. But I'm one of those people who kind of feels like there's always room to grow. You know, like even now, I don't have everything figured out, and I'm never going to have everything figured out. If I do, that's the point where I can sell the business and move on or something. But you know, I don't feel like I'm ever gonna have it all figured out. There's always room to grow, always room to do something better, to improve yourself. So, I mean, I felt like I was trying pretty hard, but I still had a lot to learn. And at that point, I think I was ready to do something different, ready to get some honest advice from people who had been at it longer than me. And yeah, I think his advice at the time felt kind of harsh, but it was exactly what I needed to do. it was what I needed to hear at the time. Yeah. It can feel really harsh when you're like a new seller and it's your product and you're putting your heart into it. And like me, I wasn't working. This was my full-time thing. You know, I was just kind of, you know, trying to figure out what I could do to make myself better and make things go.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that was just the advice I needed at the right time. Because after he told me that, it's like, okay, I'm not going to just wait another month and see what happens. I'm not going to wait another week and see what happens. Like mentally, I committed myself to giving it a year and then not quitting, but reevaluating.
Mm-hmm.
Like looking at, you know, okay, what am I doing right? What am I doing wrong? Is this, you know, worth my time? Are these the right things? Are they selling? Are they not selling? What are people interested in? You know, it wasn't so much, this is the bottom line, but I'm going to give myself a full year of trying, like actually trying, continuing what I'm doing. And then I will take a look at it and see, okay, what's working, what's not. And then I can reevaluate from a more level decision, you know, after I've had that time.
Now, were you tempted to reevaluate things before the year was up, or did you spend any time reevaluating things? Like, did you go like give it like 2 weeks and then feel tempted to be like, okay, let's see how this is going now?
Not exactly, but I did do something a little bit different.
Okay.
After a few weeks, I decided, okay, maybe some of this international stuff is getting in my way, because I feel like there's this little bit of international seller stigma, you know, to what degree, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, like you see that stuff, like, so many times I see people say something about, oh, that's in China, you know, oh, I don't want to buy from China. It could be just cheap stuff that someone's reselling. And it's not always the case, you know, but sometimes people will see, okay, you're not from the US or you're not from here. Your shipping prices are going to be higher or your products are going to be lower quality or something.
Yeah.
So in my mind, I was thinking maybe I'm battling this a little bit. Let me try going different avenues. So I started looking at, okay, what kind of things are getting my views and favorites? What kind of things are people following? What kind of things could I offer maybe digitally? Mm-hmm. And I got into crochet patterns at that point. I hadn't actually, you know, I told you I had a whole bunch of stuff I was selling, but I hadn't actually branched into patterns until around then. So I listed up some patterns, and my first sale was actually a pattern. I sold about two more of those, and then I got my first real sale for a crochet product. And that happened within about, I think from months 4 to 6, or right around there. It was about 5 months, 6 months in. So I, you know, I didn't really pause to reevaluate because I was doing something and it worked.
Sure. Yeah.
So it was finally getting that reward that I wanted. And then by Christmas time, I had accidentally found my niche, which ties back into my dog. So I don't know if you want to go that direction or not.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I would love to show this because we saw this photo early this morning and it pretty much made my week, at least, if not my month. So this was fantastic, I thought.
Yeah.
And again, so, for anyone listening, you're really missing out here. You should pull up the YouTube version of this and check this out for yourself. But we'll do our best to describe it for you.
Okay. Listen to my dog, Lola. And we talked about her a little earlier. And she's my canine model. And the niche I sort of accidentally found was making hats for dogs.
Adorable dog hats. Crocheted hats.
Yeah. And, you know, my dog had actually never worn a dog hat at all before I started making them. tried when she was a puppy. We tried to put antlers on her.
Yeah.
The picture, we have them, like, my husband's trying to hold them on her head like this, and it looks like someone's trying to strangle her or something, you know. it went horrible, and we never tried again until I found this idea for this craft. And, you know, it wasn't really my own idea. It was something that I found, again, during this process of trying to, you know, continue on and improve my shop and expand my offerings and try to find out, you know, what's popular, what's not. I had jumped on a couple of Facebook groups for my hobbies, like, you know, crochet, art, and things like that. And the one I kept finding myself drawn to was the crochet stuff. And one day someone posted up this picture of a chihuahua wearing a hat. And I was like, I can make one of those. You know, like we all get into that as crafters, you know, we get into this mindset. Well, I can make that, you know?
Yeah.
And so I found a pattern for one online and I made one and it was cute, but you know, it wasn't quite like, okay, this is awesome. Kind of cute.
Yeah.
And I kind of accidentally found my own way to make my own hats. And that's kind of where the idea of dog hats took off.
And
I listed my shop and they just exploded. Yeah. Like Christmas time. It was right around, I think, September, October.
Yeah.
And I'd come up with a Santa hat that fits a little bit differently around the dog's head, so that it doesn't fall off. Mm-hmm. Like if they shake their head, it just doesn't come off. It stays on.
Oh, you're wearing it.
Oh yeah. So that whole reindeer antler falling off thing, that's kind of what inspired it.
Yeah.
And when I came up with this design, I was so excited and I put it out there and people bought it. And, I was so surprised because until then I hadn't really sold that much. But then all of a sudden in Christmas time, I was like, okay, I've got an order today. I've got another order. I was so thrilled,
That's awesome.
So by then, it was clear to me that, doing the crochet stuff and selling the dog hats and things, was the way I wanted to explore.
Yeah.
Kind of wanted to push that direction and see what happened.
Yeah.
So that's what I've been doing a lot recently.
That's awesome.
Is kind of pushing forward to that direction, and kind of limiting out some of the other stuff. Like I've cut the jewelry and things that were just kind of side hobbies.
Mm-hmm.
It was a bit hard at first, but I've started cutting out those, side hobbies and focusing on what really works for me.
Yeah.
And this paid off. It was hard to let go of it, but I have to tell myself, okay, this is just kind of, it's not really my passion either. It was just something I was interested in at the time and trying to sell. But, I'm more happy when I'm designing and making things and people like it. So
I love your designs too. They're all over the place. You've gotten so many different ones. There's like a Captain America one that you have where it actually goes around the dog's eyes, like a mask. It just blew my mind.
Yeah.
And
dinosaur one too, and I think like a dragon dinosaur one thing that's very similar, and it got posted up on some blog last year and it went everywhere.
That's awesome.
This unicorn hat is pretty fantastic as well. And the face that Lola's making is just
I know. People love her faces
unicorn
too.
Am I a unicorn?
Yeah. I've had messages on Etsy saying, forget the hat, I want your dog.
Not for sale.
And there's Rasta
hat. She's
not
for sale.
But thank you.
Now, I noticed one of the things you're doing, too, is using social media to kind of engage potential customers and tell them, all right, send me a photo of a costume you want to see, and I'll make it. And you do it by showing examples like your Indiana Jones one, your Captain America one, and stuff like that, which are good examples of doing those things. Is that something that's worked out really well for you? Do you get a lot of feedback from people and a lot of photos of different kind of like costumes almost that they're interested in seeing?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I ran a contest, right, when I hit my 2-year anniversary.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to do a giveaway, but I don't like the way people usually do the Facebook giveaways, the social media giveaways. Usually people get on there like, follow me, like my page, and then you could win this thing.
Yeah.
But that kind of promotion just never worked for me. Mm-hmm. People will come to your page, they'll like it, and later on they'll unlike it, or they won't follow you or something. And that's not the kind of people you really want coming to you anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So what I tried to do recently is come up with contest ideas that everybody wins. Like I get something I need from it, mm-hmm. and other people get something that they want from it. So one year I did like sizes. Like I wanted people to actually measure their dog's head and give me the sizes that they had. And then in return, somebody actually won one of my hats for free. Mm-hmm. And I even shipped it for free, everything. But it was so helpful for me to get that information.
Yeah.
So even though I'm sending them a free product, no, I'm so winning because I'm getting a whole list of these different sizes and things. And the costume idea was the same sort of thing. I wanted to see what are people interested in, even if it's just like, are they into more geeky things? Are they into more like realistic things? You know, what kind of costumes are people actually wanting? And, if you ask that question on social media without the giveaway, it's fine. You're going to get some responses.
Yeah.
I did get some responses, just by asking it on its own. But the giveaway kind of gets people engaged. And I did get a lot of likes and favorites from it. Not tons and tons and hundreds of thousands. But, I have people that are coming back to me. They're the kind of people that you want involved in your pages. No mm-hmm. one who's won a giveaway has ever left my page, stopped commenting and liking. Like they're all happy mm-hmm. about, what they got, the experience they had. So I feel like by doing the giveaways, I'm getting ideas
yeah.
or information that I need. My customers are getting a chance to win something And I'm getting, you know, some loyalty in there, some good customer loyalty. So,
well, and even
they work for me the way I'm doing them.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. I was just going to say, even the customers who don't win are still getting. There's a new product that you're going to be developing too. Like they have a chance to get their hands on this cool
from
new
that
costume
contest
too.
I just ran. From that contest I just ran, the winner was a sheep.
A sheep
of all things. A sheep. Yeah. You can find it out there on one of my pages. I think I shared it on my Facebook and possibly on my Instagram. Lola wearing the sheep costume.
Sweet.
But it was like a whole costume, like a whole full thing. But that was the winner. But sheep one of dog. The runner ups was an Ewok, like a little Star Wars, nice. You know, the guy with the hood and the little, you know, ears. That was our runner. And the lady who came in next on that one, like the runner up on that one, she actually messaged me later. She's like, if you make that, I want it. So I ended up making it and she bought one. So
that's awesome.
Yeah, it works out.
That's awesome. What was the craziest thing that somebody sent in?
The craziest thing. I actually have been asked to make Santa hats for rats. I had a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle dog costume that I asked to make. That wasn't terribly crazy. It was kind of fun.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think of what else was like super crazy. But all of my designs are, I feel like they're already borderline super crazy. Yeah. I got asked once to make it, instead of like crocheting everything like I normally do, someone once asked me to make it out of spandex, which is interesting because I can't sew to save my life. So you get all kinds of questions, but you know, you learn through those. I think, who was it? Was it Kara?
Kara Button?
Yeah. Wasn't she saying something like this before? Like, you know, when your customers send you those messages with those kind of requests that they have, you know, there's an opportunity to learn there too.
Yeah.
You know, like if someone says, hey, I want this in yellow, you know, you'd be like, okay, I should offer this in yellow, or I should offer this in more colors or something, you know.
Yeah.
So when you get those kind of crazy requests to do something different like that, you know, I think it's an opportunity. So.
Yeah. I like that.
I'm still thinking about Santa hats for rats.
I know, especially crochet too. Like it seems like it'd be really hard to make them so tiny. I guess maybe
those
not.
Really tiny hats.
You have to get a really tiny hook. And some really, really tiny thread or yarn.
Oh my gosh.
Did you make
them? I did one. Yes. The lady who wanted them, I found in a Facebook group, and she ended up not buying them. So I crocheted my own little mouse to go with them, and I ended up selling that.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah. Because I don't just crochet dog hats. It just happens to be what sells. Like that and my patterns. You know, you don't really see the pattern sales as much because the pattern sales are all digital. But that and my patterns are my top selling products, definitely.
Nice.
Nice.
Now,
yeah.
you mentioned that kind of before you found your groove here and this awesome product line for your shop, that you were still working through things, right? You still had relatively good views and favorites and stuff like that, but no sales. So you probably had like some things that you were doing correctly. What in your mind were those key things outside of obviously landing on this sweet product that you would say were things that you felt like were going well for you?
Sure. Well, I feel like I've always been, again, working hard and not stopping, working hard on making improvements to my shop. A lot of these things would be redundant because you guys keep saying them all the time. Like the advice you guys give to people, I think is so great. Like working on the SEO, you know, that's something I don't ever stop doing. And if you do stop doing it, then you lose out on the seasonal stuff or things like that. So, you know, I know my SEO is always needing work. It's something I'm always going through. And that's something that I'm always doing. I'm also always doing the pictures over, you know, always.
Mm-hmm.
And that helps. That helps way more than you would believe.
Now, do you do your own photos?
I do.
Okay.
Yes.
What's your workflow look like for that real quick?
Usually for the dog hats, it's rather comical. I will put the hat on the dog, grab her favorite treats and lay on the floor or like get underneath a chair or, you know, I'm everywhere trying to get her to, you know, get the perfect pose. But,
yeah.
You know, as you can see, I mean, she's really laid back. So
she is,
you know,
super laid back. It's kind of blowing my mind.
She's old. She's 12. Almost 12. She'll be 12 this fall. So, I mean, she's just older, and she's always been very
pretty chill.
Calm.
Yeah.
But other than that, you know, for example, this past Halloween, I actually had a rush of other sales that kind of surprised me. I branched into some kids' hats that are also crochet. So it's kind of like on the same wavelength, but, you know, two-legged people instead of four-legged
people. And human
I
pets.
Had my son try. Yeah, exactly. You know, they make
you
messes. Still,
yeah, you clean up after them.
You know, exactly. You guys know it.
Yeah.
but I had him try on this hat, and it was like a Frankenstein monster hat. And I told him, "Make me your monster face." And so he makes this monster face. He's like, you know, awesome. Doing this thing. And it turned out really adorable when I took the photo.
Uh-huh.
So I put that up, and like immediately it started going. So I was just, you know, surprised how quickly that something as simple as a cute photo actually worked.
Yeah.
So I found that, you know, those photos were really something.
Mm-hmm.
Description. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm sorry. I was going to say, you use a DSLR when you take these, and then do you do editing afterwards? Because you do a nice job with your photos. You do a good job of separating your subject from the background and all kinds of things like that. And they're nice, clear photos. What kind of tools are you using when you do them yourself?
I do use a DSLR to take my photos. I have a Canon Rebel that I got several years ago as a gift. Mm-hmm. And I'm still using the same one. I've gone through at least two lenses on it because it's traveled around the world with me, literally.
Nice.
But I use that camera, and then I have to wait until the lighting is right. Mm-hmm. I wish it was light out and I could show you my view here. But we're like living along the seaside, and you can look out over my balcony and literally see the sea. So we get way too much light at certain times of the day, and at other times of the day, we get light from two different angles. And I have to be really careful and conscious of where the light's coming from, and then, you know, snap the photos at the right time of day. So I know from now, just from practicing over and over and over again, about the right time of day to take my photos. Mm-hmm. And then I do edit them afterwards. So I mean, I try not to go too overboard because you really don't want to lose the colors and things from the products, and you don't want to go out and, you know, make it look totally out there. But I do a little bit of touch up. I crop them down, make sure that they're going to look right for you know, like an Etsy preview, and then I list them up.
Nice. You were talking about the kids' products that you were working on, and I interrupted you with my question about the DSLRs, so I wanted to give you a chance to continue what you were saying.
Oh, I was just continuing on your question about, you know, what worked for me, and, you know, part of it was just the process of, you know, improving my listings. The other part of it, I think, that worked for me was, you know, not being too focused on what I wanted and trying to focus on what was popular and what the customers wanted.
Mm-hmm.
For example, I told you guys, I used to start out with art. That's kind of what got me starting my Etsy shop, is trying to sell my art. But with art, it's something that I'm passionate about a subject. I paint it.
Yeah.
And then you have to think someone else out there in the world wants it bad enough to spend the money for an original piece of art.
Yeah.
You know, that I was inspired by.
Mm-hmm.
And that whole process was really, really hard to get people enthusiastic about.
Yeah.
People would love to see it on Instagram. You'd get so many likes and things like that on your art, but no one would buy it.
Yeah.
So it was a difficult process doing that and coming to terms with the fact that, you know, you have to be willing to do what people like too. You don't have to just do that, but you have to, like, you know, be able to be open about it.
Mm-hmm.
And I found that custom pieces did pretty well for me for a while.
Okay.
So, you know, being able to take advantage of that. That's something I actually learned when I was getting my master's degree. I actually have a master's in IT, and here I am doing an Etsy shop full time. But one of our courses was on e-commerce, and the thing they always stressed in there was one of the things e-commerce has that your in-store experience doesn't have is this total ability to custom and, you know, custom make and personalize things. And Etsy is just kind of like that times 10, you know, because there are so many handmade artisans there ready and willing to do that for you. So, I mean, I for me anyway, for what I was doing at the time, like the art and the crochet and stuff, being able to custom make things was a big thing. And it still is. I got a custom request today, actually, for a dog bandana in yellow instead of blue. So, you know, being able to do what people want, versus just, you know, what you want to do all the time. You know?
I like that. That makes sense. How much time would you say, if you had to break it down between the time you spend actually like physically crocheting products and all of the other administration stuff that you have to do with SEO and photos and, you know, coming up with new listing ideas, getting feedback from customers, all that other stuff that goes into it. What would you, like, rough guess, what do you think the breakdown is for you?
Time-wise?
Yeah.
I would say I probably spend about 30% of my time fulfilling orders in the off season.
Mm-hmm.
About 30% designing new products and about 30% doing the promotions and the social media and the keeping up with things.
Mm-hmm.
During the peak season, I spend about 90% of my time on orders. You know, around Christmas time is when I get Halloween and Christmas time. I get so many.
Oh yeah.
I'm flooded. You know, I have someone here. Like she's a Turkish lady.
Mm-hmm.
She was my husband's coworker's mother. that I met last year just in case of overflow, and I haven't had to bring her on yet.
Mm-hmm.
So far, I've done everything on my own, but she's kind of like my reserve in case I need someone to help me with the patterns and stuff, because it's all my original. I mean, 95% of what I have in there is my own original designs, not something that I, you know, I'm making and selling or something.
Yeah.
But so, I mean, it's this kind of a custom thing. So it takes a lot of time to do the order fulfillment and to even just like run to the post office and try to tell them in Turkish, you know, I need this to go here. I need to just go here.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. You don't think about it. It was actually a bit of a language barrier at first. You know, I have to learn the words for what's the tracking number, you know, what's the...
Oh, boy.
You know. Yeah.
Can I talk into my phone somehow and have it tell you what I need to say?
But now they know me by name. I walk into the post office, they know me on site, and the security guard there is like, oh, come on in. And yeah, it's kind of funny that every single one of them knows me. You're like, oh, you have a package waiting here for you. Do you want to pick it up while you're here? I'm like, sure. You know, so... That's the nice thing about Turkey is that it's very personal. So there is that.
Yeah. Well, and it sounds like an amazing view too. So that's nice.
Yeah. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful area. So I'm not going to complain about that at all.
Nice.
I can think of one more thing I could talk about if you guys need something to fill the time.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. Well, one other thing I was going to offer just as advice out there that I probably forgot to mention before, has to do with one of my struggles, you know, living internationally, you know, living abroad, and having most of my customers be outside of my country. Like all of them pretty much are not here in Turkey. I think I've sold one thing here. But most of my customers are in the US, probably about 50 to 75% of them are in the US.
Mm-hmm.
And the others are scattered around Europe and Australia and just about everywhere. But the one thing I've always struggled with is shipping.
Mm-hmm.
The rates here are pretty low because the exchange rate is pretty low and the cost of living here is pretty low. So, I mean, the rates are okay, but the shipping times can be a bit of a struggle. A lot of times it takes 2 weeks to get something to the US.
Yeah.
So I can crochet it and have it in the mail in 1 to 3 days most of the time, but it's going to take 2 weeks for something to get out there. And the problem arises with that when they look at my shop and like, oh, wow, the page is all in English. They think I'm they either think I'm a native English speaker or I'm a Turkish person with really good English. but you have to like set the customer expectation.
Mm-hmm.
So that they know, you know, my product is going to take 2 weeks to arrive and they're not going to start panicking after like 3 to 5 days,
mm-hmm.
Wondering where their product is. So that's actually something that, you know, I struggle with, especially around the holidays when shipping times get even longer because you have the holiday rush and things like that.
Yeah.
So I was going to offer a piece of advice that I personally have had. And I guess I can relate it best with a story. This past Christmas, in addition to the holiday shipping problems that we always have every year, you know, everything's slowing down, There was also a strike, an airline strike with Lufthansa, and that actually impacts all outgoing mail from Europe to the U.S.
Oh, boy.
So across the Etsy forums, you could go and look and search through the Etsy forums, and all the international sellers were panicking. Yeah. Like, my order shipped 6 weeks ago. It still hasn't arrived. What's going on? And, you know, all of us were getting hit with this kind of thing. Yeah. And I was getting messages like every single day. Where's my order? I have photos coming up. Where's my order? I have a photo shoot coming up, you know, because a lot of the Santa hats and things that people order, they order for, you know, Christmas photos.
Yeah.
So I think this comes a bit from my background with, you know, support for Blackboard. You know, I have that customer service background, but one thing I've always tried really, really hard to do, and I really recommend people do as well, is to follow up with your customers and just treat them like, you know, not like even Etsy customers, but just like, you know, normal customers, people that you, you know, who don't know how the process normally works, just treat them with respect. And, you know, sometimes they get kind of, you know, antsy, like, where's my product? I needed this yesterday. You know, and it's easy to get overwhelmed because we're taking it personally because it's our product and we're trying so hard to get something out. But, you know, they don't know that, you know, they can't, they don't know who they're buying from. They can't see you. It's not like they're walking into a store and picking up something and looking at it and like, okay, you know, I want this. You know, there's not that level of trust there that you get from an in-person sale. So the one thing I was going to say as far as that kind of struggle, is to advise people to just be proactive in your communications, to talk to people, to send them the message and say, you know, hey, thank you for alerting me of this problem. You know, I will be checking on this and I will follow up with you by the end of the week or something. And then you do that follow-up. It does take extra time, but, you know, I think of all those international sellers on all those forums, I was probably the only one still getting 5-star reviews. And it was mostly because, you know, I'm out there trying to, like, you know, actually check the tracking. I bought a tracking app for my computer that actually would, like, alert me of status updates when I cleared through customs or something. And then I would actually take the extra step and follow up with the customer.
Yeah.
It took extra time. But, you know, when you think about, you know, you give it that extra 2 to 5 minutes it takes to write a quick little email. And then, you know, they know what's going on with their order. They have that extra level of trust and you save yourself that 1-star review because the shipping was late, which wasn't your fault anyway, but you know,
definitely.
So yeah, I mean, I would just say, you know, one thing I wanted to advise people of is, you know, that can be a struggle for anybody, you know, something is going to go wrong eventually. But if you treat your customers with respect and, you know, be proactive about it, even if the answer is no, you know, say it nicely and offer something. You don't have to offer a solution that makes you lose. You can offer, you know, like, you know, just, you know, if you need to get in touch with me again, here's how you can reach me, or, you know, anything. You just, as long as they show you care, you actually tried. And yeah, I mean, that's my biggest piece of advice, because I hear so often, you know, oh, this person responded to me this and it's so awful, like, what do I say to them? Like, you know, just be honest, just respond to them, be polite, you know, be respectful.
Yeah, I think that's huge too. When you think about, you know, you could put something in your shipping information in your shop or your about page or even in the listing descriptions, but there's no guarantee people are going to read that, you know, like it, ideally they would, but that by talking to them and having a much more personal connection
every year.
Yeah.
Yeah. I do every year. I use Vella. It's a tool that lets you bulk update your descriptions. And I use that to put in the first line of my description right there, you know, the shipping deadline for this is passed. It can take along this amount of time to do it, you know, just so for your information. I will still send your order if you want to place it, but there's no guarantee that it's going to arrive on time. And at Christmas time, I even put it in my shop banner. Like I edit my shop banner and I put a little note in my banner right there, as many places as I can. But still, you know, a week before Christmas, I'll be getting orders for Santa hats. But, you know, again, a lot of people with that kind of situation will just fill the order and think nothing of it. You know, okay, whatever. They wanted the hat that badly. But a lot of times they'll go the extra mile and I will go ahead and reach out to them and be like, okay, I noticed you ordered this after the deadline. This is not going to arrive in time for Christmas. Do you still want to do it? Because my policy is I accept cancellations within this amount of time of the ship date. And you'd be surprised how many times people will actually respond to me like, thank you so much. Yes, I still want to, even if it's late.
Yeah.
You know, I've had maybe one cancellation from those follow-up emails, but a lot of people are really nice about it. You know, they'll really appreciate that you're looking out for their interests too.
Yeah.
So I think you know, as sellers, we sometimes take it personally because it's our product and our labor, and we're trying so hard. And I'm not saying you have to eat your losses on these kind of situations, but, you know, if it is something like that, you know, just being communicative with people really goes a long way.
Definitely. I mean, even that customer who canceled, you know, they're probably way higher of a chance of becoming a repeat customer and buying something from you down the road just because they know you're so honest and open about everything like that.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's my philosophy on that kind of thing. You know, I've got one now who like ordered, you know, two different things, but she ordered them separately. So I'll go ahead and send her an email and say, you know, do you want me to group these together? You know, I'm planning to group these together. If you, you know, let me know within this amount of time, if you want them shipped separately, that's fine. But this way I'll save you some money. You know, I'll group them together and save you on the shipping costs.
Yeah.
And people care about that a lot.
Yeah.
You know, they really do. I feel like, again, it comes back, I think, to trust when you have like an online marketplace. You can't see those people. You can't really know who you're dealing with.
Yeah.
So I think it helps a lot.
Yeah. And I mean, that's probably one of the reasons that people shop on Etsy is because they like that personal connection with who they're buying from. And not that they necessarily even expect that kind of connection from somebody like yourself, but I mean, that's got to be so satisfying for them where, you know, so many other places when you buy products, it's just, you're just a number, you're just an order number that goes through a system and you're not updated about anything other than tracking numbers that UPS happens to have on things and stuff like that, you know, like, so I think that's really good advice for people. And, you know, kind of along the same lines, and I think we talked about this during the pre-interview chat around trust, especially, and how you were saying, you know, for international sellers, it can sometimes be a challenge for, you know, U.S.-based or maybe even like U.K.-based customers that there's a bit of a stigma around purchasing a product from, you know, somebody who's listed as their shop being in China or Ukraine or Turkey or, you know, wherever, right? That for whatever reason, that person has some kind of preconceived notion that that's more risky in some way, you know?
Right.
Have you, I mean, how, what do you do about that? Is there any tricks for that that you've kind of been happy to land on?
With that, I try to be open and honest about my location to start with. Some people try to kind of like conceal it. Like you go to their shop and there's no location there. And you know, you don't know where you're getting your thing from. So I try to be really open and honest about that, to put my information out there. And in my about page, I think I have, I'm an American expat, you know, I'm from the US originally. I try to make it clear that, you know, as far as things like that, I am where I am.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing I do is I get some inquiries sometimes from people that sound a little bit suspicious. Like, if I get this here, will it arrive by this time? Or how long does it take for this? You know, or, you know, they sound suspicious.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I try to alleviate some of those concerns in those messages.
Yeah.
So that helps. I think to a certain degree, you still get some of it because of the shipping times and things like that. And the shipping here is a little bit more expensive than it is in the US. It's not as bad as some countries, and it's definitely not as bad as shipping from the US to here.
Okay. Like, that's interesting.
Usually my shipping costs are like $3 to $5. It's really not that bad for international shipping, which I think is sometimes why people get confused and think that I'm in the U.S. or something.
Yeah, for sure.
Like there's some confusion there because it's like, oh, it's only $3 to ship this. Great.
Right, yeah.
Oh, it's only $5 for my hat, you know. Okay. So there is a bit of confusion there. But again, I try to communicate it as many places as I possibly can. And if I see someone order after that deadline, you know, I'll try to send the message if I can. Other than that, yeah, I mean, when I first started selling, I kind of tried to combat the international seller thing, which I was a bit afraid of, by branching into digital products just a little bit.
Yeah.
But ones that still fit with my product line. Like I was doing crochet and I was making my own crochet items, designing my own crochet things. And I thought, well, why not just sell the pattern too? Because then people can buy it, and people don't feel the same way about buying a digital pattern as they do about, you know, like buying a product because it's not being shipped to them.
Yeah.
You know, they get it instantly, and Etsy has a pretty smooth system for it, honestly. Mm-hmm. You can get it online afterwards and you can, you know, send it to the customer. There's so many different ways that they can get what they need.
Yeah.
So I did actually try that a little bit at the beginning when I didn't have any sales, just to kind of branch into something that could help me establish sales and reviews and trust. And that ended up working well for me in the long term. So mm-hmm. I think the moral of that story was, you know, being flexible with your products a bit, you know, just making sure that, you know, you're not stuck on too rigid of a model, you know, being able to notice what's working, what's not working, and willing to experiment a little bit and see, you know, would something else work better for me?
Yeah, that's good. And, you know, I think that's a tough one for so many people. Just they're really passionate about what they're making and stuff like that. It's oftentimes hard to take a step back and be like, you know, maybe there's not the demand here for this specific thing, even though I'm like super passionate about it and it makes complete sense to me. And why wouldn't everybody want one of these, you know?
It totally is. I've kind of felt that a lot with my like art and my jewelry and things. And it's only been recently that I've been able to kind of let go of that and realize, okay, no, I kind of found a niche that works for me. Mm-hmm. And if this is working for me and all these other things, you know, they're either getting neglected or they're taking the time away from something that is working. So it was kind of like a lose-lose, because on the one side, you know, as we've been talking about, you know, my crochet, my dog cats, those kind of things, you know, it's all kind of crochet in this little bundle over here where there's patterns and stuff. And these things are selling, they're working. But if I'm over here doing, you know, like custom portraits that take me 10 hours to make, and I'm doing all this art stuff, you know, and jewelry stuff, that's taking away from the time I could be spending designing something that sells.
Yeah.
And conversely, you know, if I'm doing the stuff that's selling, I'm neglecting like the art and stuff on this side. And the art and the jewelry and stuff is just kind of sitting there stale, stagnating. Yeah. So, I mean, I kind of ran into that problem, and that's what inspired me this year to kind of lighten up what I'm doing on, like, you know, the art and jewelry side. And I cut a lot of that stuff all together, and then I kept the crochet.
Yeah. And I mean, are you happy with how that's going so far?
You know, I was really, really upset about it at first, I'll be honest with you. You know, because sure, the art is something I'm extremely passionate about. But it has gone really well. I have not noticed a single drop in my my sales or my views, really. If anything, I think it's gone about the same, you know, maybe a little bit better. Not tons better yet, because I've just made this change within the last couple of months. But,
yeah,
you know, I was really concerned there for a bit, just, you know, dropping the art and stuff out, because it's even part of my, you know, my shop name, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like I've been able to better dedicate my time to some of the things that are working for me instead of trying to just juggle all these different things. So far, so good. I can check back with you guys and let you know for sure.
Is that now the art stuff? Is that something you still make time for just to do for yourself and your own personal sanity then? Because you just enjoy it so much? Or are you kind of spending your time elsewhere?
I do a little bit, but I haven't done very much the last like 3 to 4 months. Mm-hmm. Really since around September last year, I got really, really busy and didn't stop getting busy until around January. And after that is kind of when I started thinking about making the switch, and I just made the switch a couple months ago. So I haven't really devoted much time to the art and crafts and stuff. But my thought was, if something ever happened, you know, and I wanted to, say, have someone help me make the crochet products on the side, like bring someone else into my shop that I could help me with those. Mm-hmm. I could always go back and open another shop with the art. You know, it's not like that talent is going to go away.
Yeah.
But it's not really scalable. You know, that part of it takes my time. I'm the only one who can make, you know, my art.
Right.
It's not really something you can grow off of exactly.
Yeah.
So for now, I'm going to focus on growing this side. And then, you know, maybe if I get to the point where I'm ready, I can, you know, open a new shop and grow that side, or, you know, add that back in somehow. You know, it's not like it has to be a permanent thing. It kind of goes back to that, you know, that idea of not giving up on something, you know, that giving it a year and seeing what happens, you know, and the ability to, you know, be fluid and experiment. You know, I don't view it as, you know, giving up. I view it as, you know, I'm going to focus on this and see what happens, and then we'll go from there.
Yeah. Okay. So this is maybe a little bit kind of off topic or off train of thought, but I'm kind of just curious on your opinion on this. Have you considered doing, you know, prints of your artwork and maybe getting the price down a little bit so that the people who will look at it and really like it and connect with it aren't like hit with the sticker shock of, well, sorry, that's what original artwork costs. Is that something you've considered?
I actually looked into doing Printful for drop shipping, but their print prices were pretty high in my opinion, like compared to what I was already doing.
Yeah.
And I wasn't offering my art at that much of a price, honestly. I was kind of new to it, and I wasn't taking off. And when I first started selling, I was like, okay, I'm experimenting with pricing. And sometimes it was really low, and sometimes it was, you know, a bit higher. And I found if it was really low, sometimes it would go, sometimes it wouldn't. But, you know, none of my art was over $100. So, I mean, I don't really feel like it had that sticker shock of original art. Yeah, I mean, prints are definitely something I would consider. But I found with the art, especially, the thing that really took off for me was custom stuff. Like if I do a custom portrait for someone, I've had so many requests from one lady, especially in particular, to do like 40 different paintings for her or something, but they're all custom. You know, it's all something that, we had one last year for every letter for the Swedish alphabet of different animals. So yeah, that took a while. But, you know, you get those two extremes of products and you just, you're stretching yourself so thin. So, you know, when it came to that kind of thing, I found that custom worked really well. And I could go the custom art route and I could continue something like that and, you know, do okay with that. But in order to do that, I would need to sit down and probably increase my prices. For my original art, because I'm selling, I knew I was selling it too low. And when I started getting more of those custom pieces in, it was really clear to me, like, this is just, you know, it's eating up too much of my time and I'm not getting it yet. No, it's nowhere near maintainable. And, you know, like quality of life wise either, it's sucking up so much of your time. And, you know, if we have to move or something, you know, it just, it wouldn't be possible. So,
go ahead.
Ending my point.
That's a tough spot too, because I can, something like that, that's like so enjoyable to do, you know, sometimes when you make the move to, you know, trying to monetize it or build your business around it, it almost gets to be a drag and you're like, man, I used to really enjoy doing this. And now that there's like a time frame and pressure, it's just not as much. It's not as relaxing.
Exactly. It's definitely different when you start trying to put somebody else's vision on paper versus your own. And you have to try to kind of find a happy medium. And it's difficult. It really is difficult. But, you know, that custom aspect I found did do well. So there is potential there. And I think I could always come back to it and regrow what I started. I learned a lot from, you know, my first year on Etsy and how to, you know, build that up. So I always feel I can come back to that. But I would have to do that when I have, you know, the other side of my business figured out. And right now that's kind of what I want to focus on. I feel like that's going somewhere. This other side, you know, maybe once life settles down a bit, or, you know, once I figure things out a bit more, you know, I can always explore that.
Yeah. That's fantastic. It sounds like you're in a really good spot.
Yeah. I'm pretty happy with it. You know, I was really excited because, I hit the 800 sale milestone, which isn't like terribly much, but considering like every single one of my pieces I'm making myself, and I'm mostly sitting there crocheting dog hats. Most of that is like 800 crochet dog hats. Not exactly, but I hit that back, you know, just before my 2 year anniversary. And given that I didn't sell anything for like 6 months, I was really happy.
Fantastic.
And, you know, for some people, their goal is to make like, you know, a six figure income on it. But my goal is just, you know, like, the salaries here are low. The cost of living here is low. The supplies here are low. I just want something that will, you know, offset, you know, if I had a teaching job here, you know, I want something that's about the same as that. But let me still stay home with my kids and help do that. Exactly. And still enjoy where I am. And, you know, this whole, where we are in life, you know, it's a kind of a unique situation. Like you're talking about, like I'm living in Turkey. So I kind of want to enjoy some of that and still do something that I'm passionate about and something that I enjoy. And so this has been a really good mix for me, and I'm pretty happy where it is right now.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Richie, do you have any closing thoughts or questions? I feel like I totally monopolized and asked all the questions today. I feel bad.
Oh, you definitely did. But no, I think we covered things pretty well. Maybe a closing thought. I like how you've, you know, trimmed things down in your shop. And even though that was something, you know, you're sad about at first, you mentioned that you really like these, what you're doing right now, and really have a lot of passion for that. And it just kind of makes me think, like, sometimes you have to let go of some things that you like to make room for more things that you love to expand, because there's only like so much room in it.
Yeah.
So I liked that notion.
Yeah.
That's good.
And some people feel like it's a failure or something, but it's not. It's just, you know, choosing which way you want to grow right now, and you can always come back to it.
Yeah. It's a good way to look at it. Well, thanks for joining us, Rebecca. This is fantastic. Awesome to hear your story, and awesome to share product line. And if for anyone who hasn't checked you out yet, if they're already listening to the show, go check out Rebecca's shop. It's Aegean Drawn. It's funny because you said your shop name was tied to your artwork that you were doing. But when I read it, I was thinking more like drawn, as in you guys were drawn to the Aegean Sea area, like compelled to move there.
When I first designed it, I was like, oh, this would be a cool play on words. Like, I'm drawing things while in the Aegean region, and I'm drawn to the Aegean. I thought it'd be really cool. And then I kind of, like, started cutting this out. I'm like, oh, it doesn't work anymore. But
it half works?
Like, it kind of does. Yeah, it halfway
works. So that's cool. So, check out Rebecca's stuff. Check out her photos. She does a really nice job with those, too. And if you have...
crazy dog hats.
If you have pets, dogs, or rats... she's got something for you.
We'll make one for you. We're good.
There you go. Perfect. So thanks so much for joining us, Rebecca. It was fantastic.
My pleasure.
And for everyone else, we'll see you guys next time on Etsy Jam.